This is Alan Turing. He wrote a paper in 1950 called Computing Machinery and Intelligence. If you're interested in AI, you've probably heard about Turing and the Turing test. In this paper, he invents this idea. In this series, I want to read some of the most important papers in artificial intelligence and present them to you. All sentences you're about to hear are direct quotes and are written like this in the paper. To keep the video short, I'm not reading all of it, but only some parts that I found most interesting. Let's hear what he has to say. I propose to consider the question, can machines think? This should begin with definitions of the meaning of the terms machine and think. The definitions might be framed so as to reflect as far as possible the normal use of the words. Instead of attempting such a definition, I shall replace the question by another which is closely related and is expressed in relatively unambiguous words. The new form of the problem can be described in terms of a game which we call the imitation game. It is played with three people, a man A, a woman B, and an interrogator C. The interrogator stays in a room apart from the two. The object of the game for the interrogator is to determine which of the other two is the man and which is the woman. We now ask a question. What will happen when a machine takes part A in this game? Will the interrogator decide wrongly as often when the game is played like this as he does when the game is played between a man and a woman? These questions replace the original "Can machines think?" The new problem has the advantage of drawing a fairly sharp line between the physical and intellectual capabilities of a man. No engineer or chemist claims to be able to produce a material which is indistinguishable from human skin. The question and answer method seems to be suitable for introducing almost any one of the fields of human endeavor that we wish to include. May not machines carry out something which is ought to be described as thinking, but which is very different from what a man does? This objection is a very strong one, but at least we can say, if nevertheless a machine can be constructed to play the imitation game satisfactorily, we need not to be troubled by this objection. The question which you put in paragraph 1 will not quite be defined until we have specified what we mean by the word machine. It is natural that we should wish to permit every kind of engineering technique to be used in our machines. We wish to exclude from the machines man born in a usual manner. It is difficult to frame this definition so as to satisfy these conditions. This prompts us to abandon the requirement that every kind of technique should be permitted. We are more ready to do so in view of the fact that the present interest in thinking machines has been aroused by a particular kind of machine, usually called an electronic computer or digital computer. The idea behind digital computers may be explained by saying that these machines are intended to carry out any operations which could be done by a human computer. The human computer is supposed to be following fixed rules. He has no authority to deviate from them in any detail. We may suppose that these rules are supplied in a book, which is altered whenever he puts on a new job. The book of rules supplied to the computer is replaced in the machine by part of the store. A typical instruction might say, add the number stored in position 6809 to that in 4302 and put the result back into the latter storage position. Needless to say, it would not occur in the machine expressed in English. It would be more likely coded in a form such as 6809-430217. Here, 17 says which of the various possible operations is to be performed in the two numbers. The idea of a digital computer is an old one. Charles Babbage, professor of mathematics at Cambridge from 1828 to 1839, planned such a machine, called the analytical engine. The fact that Babbage's analytical engine was to be entirely mechanical will help us get rid ourselves of a superstition. Importance is often attached to the fact that modern computers are electrical and that the nervous system is also electrical. In the nervous system, chemical phenomena are at least as important as electrical. The feature of using electricity is thus seemed to be only a very superficial similarity. We may now consider the ground to have been cleared, and we are ready to proceed the debate on our question, can machines think? We cannot altogether abandon the original form of the problem, for opinions will differ as to the appropriateness of the substitution, and you must at least listen to what has to be said in this connection. It will simplify matters for the reader if I explain first my own beliefs in the matter. Consider first a more accurate form of the question. I believe that in about 50 years' time, it will be possible to program computers with a storage capacity of about 10 to the power of 9 to make them play the imitation game so well that an average interrogator will not have more than 70% chance of making the right identification after 5 minutes of questioning. The original question, can machines think, I believe to be too meaningless to deserve discussion. Nevertheless, I believe that at the end of the century, the use of the words and general educated opinion will have altered so much that one will be able to speak of machines thinking without expecting to be contradicted. I now proceed to consider opinions opposed to my own. The consequences of machine thinking would be so dreadful, let us hope and believe that they cannot do so. This argument is seldom expressed quite so openly as in the form above, but it affects most of us who think about it all. We like to believe that man is in some subtil way superior to the rest of creation. It is best if he can be shown to be necessarily superior, for then there is no danger of him losing his commanding position. The popularity of the theological argument is clearly connected with this feeling. It is likely to be quite strong in intellectual people, since they value the power of thinking more highly than others, and are more inclined to base their beliefs in the superiority of man on this power. I don't think that this argument is sufficiently substantial to require refutation. This argument is very well expressed in Professor Jefferson's Lister Oration from 1949, from which I quote, "Not until a machine can write a sonnet or compose a concerto because of thoughts and emotions felt, and not by the chance fall of symbols, could we agree that machine equals brain, that is, not only write it, but know it had written it." This argument appears to be a denial of the validity of our test. According to the most extreme form of this view, the only way by which one could be sure that a machine thinks is to be the machine and feel oneself thinking. Likewise, according to this view, the only way to know that a man thinks is to be that particular man. It is in fact the solipsist point of view. It may be the most logical view to hold, but it makes communication of ideas difficult. A is liable to believe that A thinks but B does not, whilst B believes B thinks but A does not. Instead of arguing continually over this point, it is usual to have the polite convention that everyone thinks. I think that most of those who support the argument from consciousness could be persuaded to abandon it, rather than to be forced into this solipsist position. They will then probably be willing to accept our test. Our most detailed information of Babbage's analytical engine comes from a memoir by Lady Lovelace. In it she states, "The analytical engine has no pretension to originate anything. It can do whatever we know how to order it to perform." It will be noted that she does not assert that the machine in question had not got the property, but rather that the evidence available to Lady Lovelace did not encourage her to believe that they did. The analytical engine was a universal digital computer so that, if its storage capacity and speed were adequate, it could, by suitable programming, be made to mimic the machine in question. This whole question will be considered again under the heading of learning machines. The nervous system is certainly not a discrete state machine. A small error in the information about the size of a nervous impulse impinging on a neuron may make a large difference in the size of the outgoing impulse. It may be argued that this being so, one cannot expect to be able to mimic the behavior of the nervous system with a discrete state system. It is true that a discrete state machine must be different from a continuous machine. But if we adhere to the conditions of the imitation game, the interrogator will not be able to make any advantage of this difference. I assume that the reader is familiar with the idea of extrasensory perception and the meaning of the four terms of it: telepathy, clairvoyance, precognition, and psychokinesis. These disturbing phenomena seem to deny all our usual scientific ideas. How should we like to discredit them? It is very difficult to rearrange one's ideas so as to fit these new facts in. Once one has accepted them, it does not seem a very big step to believe in ghosts and boogies. This argument, to my mind, is quite a strong one. One can say in reply that many scientific theories seem to remain workable in practice in spite of clashing with ESP. That in fact one can get along very nicely if one forgets about it. It is rather cold comfort that one fears that thinking is just the kind of phenomena where ESP may be especially relevant. To put the competitors into a telepathy-proof room would satisfy all requirements. The reader will have anticipated that I have not very convincing arguments of a positive nature to support my views. If I had, I should have not taken such pains to point out the fallacy in contrary views. Such evidence as I have, I shall give. Let's return for a moment to Lady Lovelace's objection, which stated that the machine can only do what we tell it to do. One could say that a man injects an idea into a machine and that it will respond to a certain extent and then drop into quiet sense, like a piano string struck with a hammer. Another simile would be an atomic pile of less than critical size. An injected idea is to correspond to a neutron entering the pile from without. Each such neutron will cause a certain disturbance, which eventually dies away. If, however, the size of the pile is sufficiently increased, the disturbance caused by such an incoming neutron will likely go on and on, increasing until the whole pile is destroyed. Is there a corresponding phenomena for minds, and is there one for machines? There does seem to be one for the human mind. The majority of them seem to be subcritical. It is to correspond in this analogy to piles of subcritical size. An idea presented to such mind will on average give rise to less than one idea in reply. A smashing proportions are supercritical. An idea presented to such a mind may give rise to a whole theory consisting of secondary and tertiary more remote ideas. Can machines be made supercritical? We may hope that machines will eventually compete with man in all purely intellectual fields, but which are the best ones to start with? Even this is a difficult decision. Many people think that a very abstract activity like playing of chess would be best. It can also be maintained that it is best to provide the machine with the best sense organs that money can buy and then teach it to understand and speak English. This process could follow the normal teaching of a child. Things would be pointed out and named, etc. Again, I do not know what the right answer is, but I think both approaches should be tried. We can only see a short distance ahead, but we can see plenty there that needs to be done.